So in understanding the process of speciation, the first thing we need to know is what isolates individuals reproductively between different species. So reproductive isolation, it can happen before fertilization, so before a zygote is formed, so that's prezygotic isolation, so fertilization never occurs in the first place. Or there might be sperm from one species that fertilizes the egg from another, but that resultant zygote does not survive. That's reproductive failure. And that means that there's no mixture in the next generation. So let's first look at prezygotic isolation. And the most intuitive way to think about this is a process called ecological separation. So you have some physical barrier, like the Grand Canyon. And the Grand Canyon is a whacking great barrier. And this little squirrel right here, the kibob squirrel, doesn't make it across the other side to mate anybody on the other side. And likewise, the Albert squirrels can't either. So there's no way they can mate with each other. This is a biogeographical barrier that's seen from space. So there's the Grand Canyon. You have the kibob plateau over here. You have the kibob squirrels. They mate with each other, but they cannot mate with these on the south side. Okay, now a common way that we get speciation is in chains of islands, and this is called island speciation. So you first get invasion of a new habitat by a small immigrant population. And when you have a small population, as we've seen, you might get the founder effect. This is a non-random genotype coming onto this new habitat. There's just a few individuals, they're mating with each other. Population may stay small. Each generation, there's a chance that certain alleles may get lost. So you have genetic drift. If the island is distinct ecologically from the mainland from which they originated, there can now be selection favoring those genotypes that prosper most dramatically well in this new ecological circumstance. So through time, you may then have an initial change because of genetic drift, then further differentiation because of selection. And this genetic differentiation becomes so large that the migrants onto our island can no longer interbreed with the original population. So even if they came into contact with each other, they wouldn't recognize each other, wouldn't want to mate with each other, or if they did, the offspring may not survive. So here's kind of a cartoon version of this. We're going to go one generation to the next. We start down here. We have two different forms, blue butterflies and green. Both are persisting in this relatively large population. Now, at this generation, there's a barrier that separates half the population from the other half. It just so happens that those on the left here didn't contain that green form. So generation after generation, they're just blue. You've got the founder effect. And over here now, again, you're getting a bit of a founder effect, and they may become more green just by chance. Okay, now the process of speciation, where you have this isolation, has something that's been around for quite a long time, and every now and then it's worth sort of taking a historical view. And I think it's really kind of a lovely example that this very famous novelist, Vladimir Nabokov, who was famous for writing Lolita, amongst a handful of other really, really excellent books, was also an amateur evolutionary biologist. And he specialized on butterflies. And so when he was the man of the year back in the day, they not only wrote about the fact that he came from Russia, but they put up pictures of the butterflies that he liked to study in his spare time. And he had this very interesting idea about how geographical separation, like we see in the process of island speciation, could lead to the formation of new species. And he suggested that there were successive waves of butterflies that migrated from Asia into the New World across the Bering Straits whenever there was an ice age and the land bridge was there and the weather was right. A few butterflies would get across. And so he said that some of the butterflies that are now found in South America, they've had longer to go all the way further down there, originally coming across the Bering Straits. And then the butterflies that are seen here in the middle part of the U.S. were a separate wave of migration. There were further waves that came across later. So he imagined there being these successive waves, and each wave led to a particular set of species. So these from Latin America are very characteristic in their color, and these from North America. But it's because a pulse coming across that had that original founder effect, selection on whatever environment they happened to encounter when they first came across, and then becoming very different. And so this has been in the news in the last few years because a recent genetic study with real details of the actual genetic material of these South American, Central American, North American butterflies, it's been able to confirm Nabokov's hypothesis that there was an original arrival of these small butterflies, that these are now all in this red lineage, and that they must have come across. Now there's a date. The dates on the prior slide, Nabokov didn't know. He just said they would have come across first. But he's right, they did come across first. And in fact, they came across about 11 million years ago and gave rise to all these that are more closely related to each other than the next wave, which came across about 9 million years ago. And these are more related to each other than the next wave that came across about 2 million years ago, and so on. So he correctly predicted the order with which they came across. The further south, the more time they'd had to get further away from their point of origin in the New World over here. And then they diversified amongst themselves. So at least in terms of these major divisions across these major groups of this large family of butterflies, it reflects successive island occupancy, as it were, in this whole great new continent of the New World. Let's look at this process using a schematic of actual islands. The idea here is that you have a mainland that's connected with thousands of square miles, lots of different individuals, but only a few make it across to a small island. They're subject to founder effect. Ecologically, this might be sufficiently different. There's selection for new characteristics. And through time, species A on this island becomes species B. It's now a new species. If there's a series of islands out there, then B may then be the source population for a few migrants that make it over to yet another island. Through time, they again become differentiated. And this process repeats, and maybe C now comes back to B, but they're sufficiently different that they'll no longer interbreed, and so on. So that we have then a diversity of different species because of this opportunity to become reproductively isolated, subject to new pressures, goes back, they no longer interbreed. And you can have a whole series of species that are very similar to each other in physical characteristics, but they're perfectly good separate species. Now, we've seen this with the Galapagos, and this is an example we'll come back to many times in this course, that we have this archipelago that's very isolated from the mainland. And there would have just been a very small number of colonist birds that made it out to one of these islands. And then through time, there was enough exchange back and forth, because it's not nearly as serious of a barrier to go from one little island to the next if you're a bird, compared to going all the way to the mainland. And what's happened is that there's now a rich diversity of finch species on the Galapagos. And each one of these islands may have any number of different species. This one has 10. This one has 10 different species of Darwin's finches. But in almost every case, it's believed that initially one of those was isolated from the rest of its kind, stayed apart long enough to form a perfectly good species, and it might have gone, but their descendants gone back to the original island. Now they coexist as separate species. So when this happens, and then also these descendant species are somewhat in competition for each other, for food with each other, they may become rather different. Because coming into an island where there's already two other finch species, and they might specialize on certain foods, well, there's a niche for you. You're going to have to feed on something slightly different. And with this kind of rapid speciation and finding a particular niche to get a food supply, that's called an adaptive radiation. And this is well known in Darwin's finches. So you have these seed-eating finches, and you're having a diversification of species from a common ancestor into a variety of ecological niches. Within this group, there's not just seed eaters. Some birds happen by chance to be able to have a weirdly long beak that made it good for them to start sucking the blood of some other bird. So here's one that's attacking the back of an albatross or a booby of some sort, and now is a bloodsucker. So that's the vampire finch. It's descended from a seed eater through this island speciation process, but it has its own ecological niche. And you have cactus finches, where they use tools to actually poke grubs, pull them out, and eat them, or even catch the insects by themselves. So this diversification, because initially they were slightly different from anything else because of the founder effect, there's an ecological advantage now to becoming more of a specialist on a certain diet, because that's the circumstances you find yourself in this new island. And this is an adaptive radiation. Now, one of the most remarkable cases of an adaptive radiation involves fish in Lake Victoria. There's a whole group of fishes called cichlids. And in Lake Victoria, which is the largest lake in Africa, there's 300 different species that descend from a common ancestor less than 100,000 years ago. Fish got into this basin from a river basin somewhere over here when the level of the lake rose high enough, it was connected to these rivers. Ancestral group got in, whole fantastic new habitats available. And what's happened through the last just 100,000 years is a remarkable adaptive variation. And what you have, adaptive radiation, what you have now are some fish that specialize on algae, some that just eat fish, some are insect eaters, some are leaf choppers, some are nail crushers. I showed the right-handed fish that like to bite a chunk out of a bigger fish, those are the scale scrapers. And all of these have appeared within Lake Victoria just in the last 100,000 years. Fantastic rate of speciation. But it's actually, even though it looks like one big continuous ecosystem, that's only true today while the lake is at relatively high levels. There have been periods over the last few tens of thousands of years where the lake level gets very low. And so these become physically separated into sort of an archipelago of these smaller lakes. They become reproductively isolated at first. They might find themselves in different combinations of other species. All this leading to very rapid speciation.